Maná. মাইক্রোফোন এগুলো করে দেখা পায়।
ओके तो मैं शुरू करता हूँ। नमस्कार, मैं विभव श्रीवास्तव, शिक्षा सहायक, राष्ट्रीय प्राणी उद्यान। हमारे YouTube चैनल के सभी दर्शकों का आज़ादी के अमृत महोत्सव के 8वें सप्ताह में हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूँ। विशेषज्ञ वार्ता की श्रृंखला में आज हम अपने दर्शकों को परिचित कराएंगे एशियाई हाथी से। एशियाई हाथी के ऊपर विशेषज्ञ के रूप में आज हमारे साथ मौजूद हैं डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार। मैं उनका राष्ट्रीय प्राणी उद्यान के परिवार की तरफ से हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं।
थैंक यू।
साथ ही राष्ट्रीय प्राणी उद्यान से हमारे साथ मौजूद हैं डॉक्टर अभिजीत भावल, पशु चिकित्सा अधिकारी, सुश्री प्रियंका चौधरी, शिक्षा सहायक, और मानसी कुमार, एकेडमिक वॉलंटियर। मैं आप सभी का भी स्वागत करता हूं। वार्ता शुरू करने से पहले मैं डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार का एक संक्षिप्त परिचय देना चाहता हूं। डॉक्टर तालुकदार को करीब 20 वर्षों का वन्य जीवों के साथ कार्य करने का अनुभव रहा है। इन्होंने आसाम में अपने करियर की शुरुआत की और वहां इन्होंने MVSC यानी पशु चिकित्सा विज्ञान में इन्होंने परास्नातक की डिग्री प्राप्त की। उसके पश्चात इन्होंने अरण्यक, जो कि एक ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है वाइल्ड लाइफ वन्य जीव संरक्षण का आसाम में, उसके साथ कार्य किया। फिर इन्होंने वाइल्ड लाइफ ट्रस्ट ऑफ इंडिया के साथ कार्य किया। इन दोनों ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के साथ कार्य करते हुए इन्होंने मानव वन्य जीव संघर्ष के ऊपर काफी वर्क किया और इनकी विशेषता बड़े स्तनधारी जैसे हाथी और गैंडे जैसे जीवों के ऊपर इन्होंने विशेषज्ञता हासिल की। अपने उल्लेखनीय कार्यों और शोध की वजह से इनको विभिन्न पुरस्कार तथा इनको विभिन्न ग्रांट भी दिए गए। तो अब मैं डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार जी से अभी डॉक्टर तालुकदार वर्तमान में दुबई सफारी उद्यान में प्रमुख पशु चिकित्सा अधिकारी हैं। तो अब मैं डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार जी से निवेदन करता हूं कि कृपया वो हमारे दर्शकों को एशियाई हाथी के बारे में अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन से अवगत कराएं। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद विभव। मैं क्योंकि ये टेक्निकल है थोड़ा, तो मैं चाहूँगा कि मैं ये पूरा प्रेजेंटेशन इंग्लिश में पेश करूँ, बीच बीच में मैं हिंदी का सहाय भी जरूर लूंगा।
बिल्कुल सर।
थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर अभिजीत एंड विभव। आई लाइक टू प्रेजेंट दिस ऑन एशियन एलिफेंट्स। एशियन एलिफेंट्स वी हैव बीन आई हैव बीन एसोसिएटेड विद एलिफेंट्स नाउ फॉर लाइक 20 ईयर्स, सो वी हैव कम अक्रॉस लॉट्स ऑफ hurdles, lots of problems of Asian living. Let's see, as we go ahead, we can see, discuss about everything. So, elephants generally, Asian elephants, they belong to the family Elephantidae, genus is Elephas, and we have 4 subspecies of Asian elephants, namely the Indian elephant, the Sri Lankan elephant, Bornean and Sumatran elephants. Bornean and Sumatran are very less, while the range of Asian the Indian elephants are the most, and Sri Lankan elephants are the least number, but they are the largest in of all the species. Other than that, we have one species of African elephant, the Loxodonta, which comprises of 2 subspecies, the bush elephant and the forest elephants. Distribution of Asian elephants, mostly it starts from China and up to Sri Lanka and here up to Indonesia. So all these range countries include India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Cambodia, China, Indonesia, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Vietnam, and Laos. And they prefer habitat mostly the grasslands, floodplains like we have in Assam, the evergreen rainforest, deciduous forest, and shrubs. You can find elephant in these habitats. But due to the fragmentation of habitat, there is shrinkage now. It has reduced to few areas now. So regarding their food preference, they eat mostly plants, leaves, like crops like paddy, bananas, sugarcane. They come to rate these crops basically when you use a sugarcane field or a paddy field, right? If you rate it for like consume it for 1 hour, it is equivalent to like 5 to 6 hours of foraging in the forest. So because of all this conflict, they will prefer to rate the crops. And regarding their physiology, and physiology, they have like 21 months of gestation period. It ranges from 18 to 22 months. So 21 months is the average. Generally, one calf is born after its gestation, but there are so many records of like twins also. Their breeding interval is 4 to 5 years because the mother will take care of the calf for 3 to 4 years. So after that, she will come to heat again, and she will conceive again. Then we can have the next baby. And in the wild, those herds, the elephant herds, are mostly led by the oldest female elephant in the herd, which is called the matriarch. And the adult male elephants, they generally roam around lonely. They are solitary males, and they join the herd during mating season. Some facts about the African and the Asian elephants. The African elephants are much larger than the Asian elephants. Their highest point is the back, while the Asian elephants, the highest point is the shoulder. So they have single finger-like projection in case of Asian elephants, while the African elephants have the two fingertips at the tip of the trunk. Elephants are the largest terrestrial animals in Asia. Sadly, there are only 45,000 elephants left, Asian elephants left. And among that, every one in three elephants are in captivity. So you can imagine that what is the necessity of proper care and management of captive Asian elephants. Since we have one third of the population in captivity and the habitat is fragmenting, it is disappearing. So it is utmost important to take care of the captive elephants. Their lifespan ranges from 60 to 70 years in the wild, while in captivity there are records of like 80 to 85 years. While the females weigh around like 2,500 kgs, and the male, they range from 3,500 to 5,000 kilos. Their basic traits is habitat loss, as we have already discussed. The habitat loss is mostly because of our development projects like the roads, dams, and spreading of human settlements, which is always growing. Our human population is ever growing, so it is occupying the wildlife habitats, and that is why there is fragmentation of the elephant habitats as well. So that is a big threat for the elephants. Because of the fragmented habitats, the elephant generally, they come in contact with the human habitations. They go to the villages for crop raiding and other conflict issues. So that's why they come in a big conflict with the humans. And there is loss of properties and sometimes human lives also. There is casualties of elephants also. So that these are like habitat loss is the main cause of the shrinkage of elephant habitat. And that's why in retaliation, the villagers, they kill the elephants like by intentional electrocution, gunshots, spearing, and poisoning. I would like to share a small video. This is one elephant, if Abhijit also remember, this elephant was a big tusker around Kaziranga. It will go to the crop every evening, and it gets spared by the villagers because the villagers also need to protect their crops. They will spare it, they will chase it away with crackers and everything. And it comes back to the forest like this, injured. And we had hard time in managing it, removing the spears, darting it. It was a huge tusker, around like 10 feet tall. So we were removing those. You can see the spear hanging. These spears are generally made like red hot, and they are put into the body, so they go very deep. So we're trying to give some like care, antibiotics and all to cover the wounds. We are splashing some water after the anesthesia. Before recovering from the anesthesia, we'll just trying to cool it down. These are like 6-7 spears we could remove from the elephant. This is another calf. You can see the big injury on the head. This elephant calf, I think it followed the heart to a village, and the village says they were the heart. This calf was trapped and somebody just hacked the forehead into a big injury. Just a minute, I'll share the video. Mana. Is it visible?
Yes, visible. Yes.
Thank you. So you can see the injuries on the head. You can see the how far a human being can go and just injure this calf. This calf is around like 2 to 3 months old. It cannot do any harm to anyone, but out of like, what do I say, like retaliation, somebody has injured it with a big injury. So the forehead was severed into like deep enough, so we sedated the animal and we tried to manage it surgically. This was way back in 2012, so 10 years. This calf has recovered well, and the team, our rehabilitation team, could put it back to the wild. But it had some issues because the elephant rehabilitation is quite challenging. So it kept coming back to the forest camps. So I think finally this calf was trained and kept as a captive elephant now. The other problem in this habitat is we have lots of tea gardens in the elephant habitats, which are like transferred into tea gardens. They were originally elephant habitats, and the tea gardens have lots of drains, like for the irrigation. If you know the tea gardens, they need high rainfall, but there should not be water logging. So to drain those water, there are lots of drains which are quite deep, maybe 10 to 12 feet deep. So when this herd are chased away by the villagers towards the tea gardens, the small calves, they fall into these ditches and get trapped. Here you can see one calf that is that fell into the trench, and the mother, while she tried to pull out the calf, she also got trapped. And we could took out the calf and hand raised it. We could hand raise it for like 4 or 5 years, then we put it back to the wild. But sadly, the mother succumbed to she was suffocated in the trench and she died there. Most of the time, we when we are on time, we could try to rescue these elephant calves. We try to pull it out of the trenches. इज इट विजिबल? This cup fell into the trends in the maybe in the late evening, and next morning while tea garden workers they were around to for plucking tea leaves, they saw the cup in the drains, and while it was shouting, so we could go there and made slopes in the drain and help it go out and put it back with the heart. But every time we are not lucky, rather the elephants are not lucky, we are not informed on time, and they generally succumb into this inside these trenches. You can imagine how deep these drains are. They are like 12 to 15 feet deep. So it is quite difficult to pull them out. But with the help of the tea garden workers, they help a lot, and we could pull it out. You can see it came out, and we pushed it towards the nettle heart. And by the evening, it was with the heart. Many times we don't reach the spot on time, we are late, and by that time I think this calf, if you can see that the heart tried to pull it out, maybe it was badly injured, and it died in the trench. It was very unusual to see this calf here, because it looks like the heart has put some soil on top of it. Otherwise, I don't know what is this behavior, but we found it like this. The other trait is this railway tracks that run in through the elephant habitats in many areas. I know most areas in Assam. This is Deporville, if you can see. So this is the big water body, and we have the Garo Hills, the Meghalaya Hills on the right side. The elephants, they do come down for water, and while crossing these train tracks, railway tracks, sometimes they get trapped. They cannot escape when there is a speeding train. If they are in the bridge or in the edges where there is no scope of escape, they are hit by the trains, and we have casualties. If you see this video, you can see this calf. This calf was delivered after the mother was hit by the train. So we found it early in the morning. This is like 2-3 hours old calf. You can see some mud here on the bridge. So this is a mark of the elephant that was made after it was hit by the train. It was dragged until here. There were actually three elephants. One succumbed to the injuries immediately. It was found below that bridge in the morning. It had severe like traumatic injuries. It had fractured bones. And the other side, this is the mother of that calf that delivered early in the morning before people reached there. I think after this hit, the train hit her, she delivered the baby. She had a fractured femur. She fractured her leg, and like when people started gathering in the morning, she tried to go near the baby, but people chased it away, so she kept going towards the hills. You can see the placenta hanging. It is quite disturbing to see this video. Yeah. Sadly, she succumbed to the injuries after 3-4 days. Because it's quite difficult to manage a fracture of wild animals. The other threat is electrocution. We have lots of, as you see in this news cutting, right, 90 elephants has been electrocuted in Assam since 2011. Quite disturbing. So we have lots of conflict areas where there are the forest department and is putting electric fence so that the elephant, they don't go to the crops. But looking at those electric fence, some people, they don't know how to set up a proper electric fence. They just put wires and connect it to electricity. They don't know how it is used. So it leads to like electrocution of elephants. We have lost many elephants in the last like 10, 12 years because of electrocution. And there are some also sagging low power lines, which also is the cause of this electrocution. And all this shrinking of habitat, the fragmentation of the habitat has led to elephants confined in small pockets. And as a result, the genetic flow will not be there as it should be. So slowly there will be inbreeding depression, and which will result in like more diseases. They will have more parasitic load because a small habitat cannot support a big herd of elephants. So because of that shortage of food, their carrying capacity will go down, and ultimately we'll lose elephants. Illegal hunting and trade. This is not a big threat in India right now, because most of the ivory that is in demand, right, in the market, that are mostly, it was currently it is coming from the African sources. So if you see that in Africa, almost every day there is an estimate that 100 elephants are being killed. So most of the source of ivory is from Africa now. So we don't have much pressure for the ivory in Asian elephants. The other cause is Asian elephants, only few of the selected males, they have this task. That is also a big problem, because if the poachers, they target those taskers and eliminate those from the group, so we will not be left with that quality gene that will flow for the taskers. So it will slowly go down. But right now, illegal hunting and trade is not a big issue in Indian elephants. As we know that the elephants, they are like classified as endangered by the IUCN Red List, and about 45,000 left Asian elephants left in the wild. And since we have elephants like 6,000 BC, so now overall elephant, out of 3 elephants in the wild, we have 1 in captivity. That makes like 15,000 estimated elephants in captivity. So it is utmost necessary to have a very good program to support these elephants in captivity. We need a very good health care program. Their legislation, their policies has to be very clear so that we can support the species. And what are the traits for these captive elephants? As we all know, these elephants were mostly, they were all engaged in logging activities in the past. Rather, we also keep them some in the temples, some definitely we see them begging on the streets, but they were mostly engaged. They were in the logging industry. After the ban of this logging, these elephants have become a beast of burden. Like if we keep 2 elephants in a zoo, we know what are the responsibilities, what are the demands to be fulfilled to keep one elephant in captivity. So 15,000 elephants in the captivity, they really need good care and good amount of resources. So once they have been unemployed, they have become a beast of burden. So since they are not earning, their care has gone down, like comparatively it has gone down so much that they don't get proper nutrition and sufficient care. So the mounts, which were the specialist to keep these elephants in captivity, they are also not like supported well. The mounts, they don't earn much. The owners, they don't earn much, to support the mounts. So that skill is also slowly disappearing. It is dying out. So the children, they are no more interested in this elephant care. We are lacking the ability of the skilled mounts to keep elephants. For that, it is resulting in poor management of the elephants in captivity. So we need some to have some better care for these elephants in captivity. Like we can initiate some centers. Like we already have some shelter facilities for elephants. So we can have some facilities which can facilitate elephants, their veterinary care. They can get proper food, and they can also have, they can be used for tourism and all. And we can have those conflict animals, the males which are in mass. We can keep them like securely, so that they don't do any harm to the people around. For the captive management, we need to have a very good preventive medicine program. Like if we have like 15,000 elephants in captivity, we should have a program, good program, which need to be supported by like the authorities. Like we need to have some periodic healthcare program, the screening them, right? This is some kits that we did for bovine tuberculosis. We used those kits to check the prevalence of the disease in elephants. So we should have some program like this. We should do the vaccinations for the endemic disease, that they might suffer from some disease. So we should have the vaccination program, like they suffer from clostridial infection, pasteurella, and anthrax. These are three like bacterial infection we can cover with vaccination. Foot and mouth disease is important, rabies and tetanus. We should do periodic fecal analysis, because parasitic load is one of the major problem of captive elephants. So we should periodically see the fecal samples and deworming as per the prevalent parasites. That is very important for captive elephant management. Food care, they need food care, because when you keep elephants in captivity, they lack proper exercise. They don't walk much, so they will be obese, and if we do not take care of the food properly, then there will be lots of problems, like fungal infection. We get a lot, the cracks and broken toenails. So this need to be cared periodically. Socialization and mating opportunities. So at just to enrich their activities, they need all this, because they are very socially bonded animals. They need socialization. Most elephant in captivity, they are spending, in some of the zoos, they're spending their lifetime alone without any socialization or mating opportunities. This has to be taken care of properly. So to keep one elephant in captivity, we must know about their like signs of health. So these are a few signs of the health. What is a health? It is when all the system of the body functions normally, right? And there is no deviation from the normalcy. This is health. So we need to know, what are the signs of health? A healthy elephant will be always alert. It will respond to you, to your presence. It will respond to your calls. It will have bright eyes, moist eyes, and it will be flagging the ears continuously. That is a very good sign of a healthy elephant. That there will be movement of the trunks and the tail. It will be like flagging the tails also all the time. Will bear weight in all the limbs, and periodically it will transfer the weight from one to another. You can see that they will be cross-legged most of the times, right? When they are resting, they will be cross-legged, so that they will shift the weight from one limb to another. Elephants, they spend most of the time while they are not asleep, right? They spend most of the time in feeding. Like they are said to be like spending 18 hours in an average out of 24 hours the whole day, right? They will be spending in feeding. So this is a very good sign. An active elephant, a healthy elephant will be eating all the time. And there will be the tip of the trunk will always be moist. When you feel it, right, it will be like moist. There will be some discharge. The visible mucous membranes, right, of the eye and the like lips, tongues, it will be always pinkish and moist. And the skin will be wrinkled. It will not be dry. The urine and the dung output will be sufficient, which you can find out. And these are the body temperature and respiration, which we can measure. And what are the signs of illness? It is any deviation from health is illness. Like you'll see the animal is drowsy, it's not responsive. Skin is very dry, looks dehydrated, the eyes are shrunken, and there will be excessive lacrimation. The trunk will be like laid down and it will not done much. There is no much movement of the trunk. And there will be rise of temperature, anorexia. It will not be interested in feeding or it will not be drinking enough. Loose dung with mucus or blood. And it will be trying to frequently lie down or it will get up. Some of the problems of elephants in captivity that we have encountered, that mostly the parasitic problems, when you don't give enough care, it does not move, because the parasitic problem is because the elephant is not moving enough. So it will be using the same area, it will be soiled with the feces and urine. So there is a chance of picking up some infection. So there are some major gastrointestinal helminths, parasites that we encounter in elephants. The liver flukes are very important. It damages the livers. It is basically a problem in elephants which are around like water bodies. They pick up the parasites from the intermediate host, which is like snails. So this is important to periodically check them for these parasites. Other than that, we have those filaria, trypanosoma, some infection of mites and lice. And gastric mites. We have a parasite called Cobboldia, which cause intestinal migration and they come out in the feces. And when the animal is infested with parasites, you can see the signs like this. You can mostly you can see they will pick up soil. It will try to eat soil from the earth. And it will be in colic, it will show signs of colic, it will be touching the abdomen with the trunk. Stones, deworming these parasites were expelled in the feces. So you need to do periodic fecal analysis to know the endoparasitic load so that you can give the supportive treatment and the anthelmintics so that you can get rid of these parasites. This is the mice, you can see this eggs of Cobboldia on the tusk. So this is what we meant to say when we said because the management of captive elephant will go down when we will lose the skilled mahouts. So the skilled mahouts who know how to take care of the elephants, what they need to see, check every day. So they will find out that this elephant has been infested with these parasites. They will see these eggs. When experienced mouth will see these eggs, and what they do, they remove this by scrubbing with while giving a bath to the elephant. They will scrub it and they will remove this. Otherwise, these eggs are ingested through mouth, and in the stomach they will develop into this adult, in this larvae. So this larvae will cause mysis. It will migrate and finally it will be expelled with the feces. Filariasis, it's endemic in some areas. We found them in some areas in the forest, these captive elephants, but this is not a fatal case, but it is very irritated from human. So it is of zoonotic importance. So tuberculosis is an important disease of captive elephants, as there is a chance to be transferred to the mouth or the handlers. Or if it is in a like tourist elephant, it may be spread to the tourists also. So it has to be taken care of. We can screen tuberculosis periodically. We have lots of tools to screen tuberculosis. Tetanus, hemorrhagic septicemia, anthrax, endemic in some areas. and salmonella. These are the few important diseases. We have not many diseases, but these are the most common and important diseases in captive elephants. Herpes virus infection in elephants. This is a case that I encountered. We acquired these elephant cubs in Dubai Safari. They came here at the age of like 4 to 5 years of age, and after like 6-7 months of being kept in safari, one of the elephants, they started growing these papillomas. So it took terribly in 2 weeks, and they attained the size of a tennis ball. So we had to remove it. What we did, we removed the lesions septically. We took the samples out in normal saline. We sent it to the lab. They prepared an autogenous vaccine out of these lesions. And the vaccine were injected to the elephants at a gap of 1 month. And since then, we got rid of this papillon. There is no new growth. So we're still monitoring these elephants closely so that we can take care of them if some grows again. But till now, they have been good. There is no other growth like this. Non-specific disease, you can get lots of injuries in elephant. You cannot describe it. Like these are tail injuries, which are often beaten by others. When they are in a conflict, the aggressive one will bite the tail. So this is commonly found in most of the elephants, in captive elephants. This is a rhino injury. It is one in one is a rhino. So this is caused by a rhino bite. Question of abscess, and finally, and if you lose one leg, one elephant, then you lose the elephant. So this need to be cared properly. You should have a very good program to periodically check the food. You need a good food care program so that you can attend to it like weekly. Maybe weekly you clean it, trim it. So it is very important. So these are few of the captive elephants that are under our care. So we clean them weekly. This was because these cubs were very small. They were not trained like the Asian elephants. These are African elephants. So it took us some time to train them enough, because we do protected contact. So we have to train them to give us the leg, the suitable food, so that we can take care. So it needs lots of patience. The elephants will finally, they have been like trained enough so that we can do the food care properly weekly. We do it weekly now. Other problems are trauma, and trauma we see in some elephants because of the trauma, when there is some bad points on the forehead, if it has trauma, then it results in corneal opacity, corneal ulcers. So even in some cases, there is some deficiency of vitamins will also lead to corneal opacity. So this need to be taken care of. Eye is very important for the elephant, but we have seen lots of blind eyes in captive elephants. Elephants in zoos, is it really necessary? I think the Central Zoo Authority and Project Elephant, they have already have one notification to send all the zoos, all the zoo elephants back to the wild. So how do a zoo represent one elephant? It is not in the, you cannot give any proper care, you cannot give the habitat, you cannot give the social requirements. So elephant in zoo is definitely a big no. So they can go back to the wild if we can manage them in semi intensive care, where they can go to big area and come back. That's how we need to manage the capabilities. But in zoo for education, definitely no. And elephants in temples, you can decide. This is one of the elephant in one of the famous temple in South India, which is a celebrity now. But can you think about the elephant, how it is feeling? Is it feeling good because of lots of people around shouting. Definitely, we had lots of casualties of human also every year in the temple elephants. So we need to decide on that. Thank you so much. Can we now start for the discussion?
थैंक यू सर, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका। आपने काफ़ी अच्छी जानकारी दी हमें। हमारे एक दो साथ जुड़ी हुई हैं जो शिक्षा सहायक हैं, सुश्री प्रियंका चौधरी, वो थोड़ा जानना चाहती थी कि जो एलिफेंट्स के लिए एनरिचमेंट क्या क्या किए जा सकते हैं, या आपके दुबई जू में क्या क्या एनरिचमेंट अभी तक किए गए हैं एलिफेंट्स के, जो हम यहाँ पे अपने दिल्ली जू में भी उसको कर सकते हैं।
डेफिनेटली हमने जो बात किया अभी कि कोई भी जू ना, जू ये एलिफेंट का जो सोशल रिक्वायरमेंट है, जो उसका हैबिटेट है, जिसको जितना उसको केयर चाहिए, फूड वेरिएशन चाहिए, उसको फोरेजिंग चाहिए, फोडर चाहिए, यू कैनॉट प्रोवाइड ऑल दैट इन ए जू। सो एलिफेंट बींग वन ऑफ द मोस्ट सेंसिटिव स्पीसीज and with such a social requirement, and if you see their like memory also, they have very good memories. So elephant, they don't fit into zoos. So even if they don't fit into zoos, when you keep them in zoos, so enrichment is the most important thing. So हमने अपने zoo में हमने बहुत सारे enrichment tool रखे हैं, जैसे इन लोगों फीडिंग, जैसे एशियन एलिफेंट हो गया, दे आर ग्रेजर्स, वो लोग ग्रेजिंग करते हैं, लेकिन अफ्रीकन एलिफेंट्स दे आर ब्राउजर्स। सो हम लोग कलेक्ट करते हैं बहुत सारे ब्राउज, जो अफ्रीकन स्पीसीज का ब्राउज है, हमने उसका प्लांटेशन भी किया है काफ़ी, तो वो हम लोग कलेक्ट करके वो देते हैं। वी हैव दुबई, क्योंकि बहुत गर्म है, इफ यू आई थिंक यू नो अबाउट इट, सो वो एलिफेंट के लिए सुटेबल इतना भी नहीं है। सो वी हैव sprinklers, we have water splashes, so which is very useful for these elephants. So हमने काफी टूल रखे हैं। If you want to need more, I can share with Dr. Abhijit also. I can share all the enrichment tools with Abhijit, so you can definitely look into it. बाकी दूसरा जो बात है ना, the food that we provide in zoos, वो that is nowhere near to natural. So हम लोग तो यहाँ एक फोडर मिलते हैं, we get some browse, हम लोग फोडर यहाँ cultivate करते हैं, वो बाहर से आते हैं, है। लेकिन I think for Indian zoos we need to consider the feeding very seriously. उनको एक क्योंकि इंडिया में इतने सारे zoo है, we have lots of elephants even in forest also, we need to have a very good we can develop a pellet, we get a pellet from Africa for the African elephants, but similar I think we can make one for our Indian zoos, Indian captive elephants, that we can have a good pellet, we can
good solution,
we can formulate a very good pellet which we can discuss, and that will be very helpful.
थैंक यू सर, हम काफ़ी कुछ एनरिचमेंट करते भी हैं, हम वो भी आपसे शेयर करेंगे। हम अपने हाँ एलिफेंट्स के लिए हमने काफ़ी एनरिचमेंट किए भी हैं, और हम स्पेशल डे भी मनाते हैं एलिफेंट स्पॉट्स, एंड मेक सच एन अरेंजमेंट विद द रेलवे मिनिस्ट्री सो दैट इट इज़ मैंडेटरी टू लिमिट द ट्रेन स्पीड इन द एफरमेंशनड हॉट स्पॉट्स टू प्रिवेंट कोलिजंस।
अमन जी हेलो, there are lots of projects, ongoing projects both from government of India, Project Elephant, and a few NGOs that I worked with also, WWF, Wildlife Trust of India. They have few good projects for this elephant train heat mitigation. उन लोगों ने काफी सारे स्पॉट जो है ना उसको आइडेंटिफाई किया है, उसमें पेट्रोलिंग यूनिट भी है, दे पेट्रोल द ट्रैक्स फॉर द एलिफेंट मूवमेंट एवरी नाइट, लेकिन फिर भी बिकॉज ऑफ ह्यूमन एरर और कभी जो ट्रेन है ना, ट्रेन के आई एम नॉट श्योर, आई कैन नॉट से यू श्योरली दैट बिकॉज ऑफ द एरर ऑफ रेलवेज ऑल्सो, मे बी दे समहाउ दे ओवरलुक द warnings that there are elephants on the train railway tracks, and they don't, as a result, we still have lots of casualties in elephants, and it is one of the major cause of elephant mortality in our areas. Like, I know few areas in Karbi Anglong, in Sonitpur, and in this Deepotville area, Moriyani, yeah. In Sonapur also, I had a few elephant casualties that we attended. So these areas are already identified. They have been attended. We have projects going on, but definitely because of negligence and human error, we still have these casualties.
मुझे याद है सर कि जब मैं हम लोग जब मैं देहरादून में था वाइल्ड लाइफ इंस्टीट्यूट में, तो वहाँ पे जब हम देहरादून जाते थे हरिद्वार से, तो रास्ते में राजा जी का जो पैच पड़ता है, राजा जी वाला जो एरिया पड़ता है, वहाँ पे भी जो भी ट्रेन ट्रैक होता है उसके साइड में स्पीड भी लिखी होती है, शायद उसी एलिफेंट कॉन्फ्लिक्ट की वजह से, जो भी एक्सीडेंट की वजह से.
हाँ भाई साहब, ये एलिफेंट का जो स्पीड है ना, इट ऑल्सो हैज यू ऑल्सो हैव टू थिंक अबाउट द रेलवेज. इट्स नॉट दैट वी कैन टेल देम दैट यू ड्राइव योर ट्रेन एट द स्पीड ऑफ 10 इन दिस एरिया, राइट? सो व्हेन यू ऑपरेट एट रेलवे इंजिन विथ ऑल दिस लोड, राइट, द ट्रेन नीड टू बी एट ए सर्टेन स्पीड. नहीं करते तो ट्रेन वहां से जाएगा नहीं,
स्टॉप
नॉट कूल द ट्रेन. So that is a limitation on their part also. So best thing is to monitor them and give early signal कि यहाँ यहाँ elephants है, आप थोड़ा रुक दीजिए, and the patrolling staff can they can see, take the elephants out of the way. That is a possibility they have been doing. So यही है, they have this limitation.
I just would like to add, Anjanda.
Yeah.
I would like to.
हो सकता है हमारे चिड़ियाघरों में और अदर जहाँ पे भी हाथी को हम रखते हैं, तो उसके बारे में बहुत अच्छी जानकारी दी, किस किस प्रकार की बीमारियाँ उनको हो सकती हैं, कितना मुश्किल है. और सबसे बड़ी बात यह कि महावत का कितना बड़ा रोल होता है एक एलिफेंट के उचित रख रखाव में, इसके बारे में आपने बताया. तो सर, अब मैं डॉक्टर अभिजीत भवाल से निवेदन करता हूँ कि वो कृपया वोट ऑफ थैंक्स, धन्यवाद ज्ञापन करें.
थैंक यू विभव. सबसे पहले मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा मेरे मित्र, मेरे सीनियर डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार को, जिन्होंने बहुत ही कम समय में इतनी महत्वपूर्ण और इतनी रोचक जानकारी दी. हालांकि मैं डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार को बहुत सालों से जानता हूँ, उनका इस फील्ड में जो काफ़ी योगदान है और उनका जो काम है वो मुझे बहुत ही भावित करता है. और जब ये वर्कशॉप हमने आयोजित की आज़ादी का अमृत महोत्सव में हाथियों का, तो मैंने डॉक्टर अंजन तालुकदार से रिक्वेस्ट किया और मैं उनका शुक्रिया अदा करता हूं कि वो आए और उन्होंने इतनी अच्छी इंफॉर्मेशन और एक्सपीरियंस अपने सामने से शेयर की. और मुझे मैं बहुत श्योर हूं कि हमारे स्टूडेंट्स और जो भी लोग इससे सुनेंगे, ये वाइल्ड लाइफ साइंस और इसके फ्यूचर के लिए काम करेंगे. मैं धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा प्रियंका चौधरी, विभव और हमारे वॉलेंटियर्स, जिन्होंने बहुत ही